and give God some praise in the house. Hallelujah. All right. I need help this morning because God has the victory. We read the end of the book. So no matter what the devil has thrown at you or will throw at you, we know the end of the story, right? Amen? Hello? Come on, let's wake up this morning. Hallelujah. I'm thankful he won the victory for me. How about you? Amen. We couldn't afford. Amen.
Good morning, Remedy Church. Hope you've had a great week in the Lord. As you came in the doors this morning, you got a bulletin, and inside that bulletin was a flap. And we would like for all of our first-time guests, first of all, let's give all our first-time guests a round of applause because they're special here today. If you're a first-time guest, or if you just had a need that you would like our church to pray for, please fill that out and put that in the offering plate because we believe in prayer. We believe that the Lord is still on the throne and that the Lord wants to meet your need. He said He'll meet your need according to His riches and glory. Today, the theme of our church today is victory. We're going to be having baptism today, which is the ultimate victory because the Lord reached down and met us where we are and pulled us up out of the miry clay. And as a testimony for what the Lord does. I don't know about you, but my family's been going through a lot lately. And it seems like we've just been beat down and beat down and beat down. And as I was sitting there playing the song about victory in Jesus, the thought came to me about the children of Israel marching around Jericho. And the Lord told them to march around 7 days. And they marched. And they got through the first day and the second day. And it's like, why in the world am I going through this? Why am I going through all this struggle? And there's so many times that the enemy's in our ears and we get to that fifth and that sixth day of going through it. And he says, you just need to give up. And we're one day away. We're one day away. And this might be the beginning of your seventh day. Where you come in and you march around that seventh time and you get to that seventh time and the Lord told them to shout the shout of victory. And when they shouted that shout of victory, the walls came down. We need to shout the shout of victory today because we are overcomers by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. So let's raise a shout to the Lord today as we praise Him. Let's pray. Father, we come to You right now, Lord, and we thank You that we are not defeated, but You won the victory for us on the cross of Calvary. And Lord, I thank You that You're with us wherever we go, whatever circumstance we're facing today. And Lord Jesus, I pray that You would reach down right now with Your almighty hand. And that, Lord Jesus, that You would lift us up. And whatever lie the enemy is telling us right now, he is a liar and the truth is not in him. And Lord, we give You all the praise and glory for it in Your precious and holy name. Amen. Let's worship Him today.
We don't have to fight it ourselves. He's fighting for you. This is how I fight my battles. Just praise Him through it. This is how I fight my battles. 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 God says, put legs on your face. It's enough to believe, but are you going to do something about it? He's fighting for you, but he wants you to take some action. Every time he heals somebody in the Bible, he said, go and do this. Go wash. Go tell the priest that you are healed, right? Do you need something from God? Is he already telling you that you are healed? That he's already taken care of a situation, and now he just wants you to praise him for it? Is that what's going on right now? Come on. Raise up a shout to him. Let him know that you trust him. He is no respecter of persons. Come on. This is how I fight my battles. 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 This is how. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. Even when it's uncomfortable. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. It may look like. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm
This is how I fight my battles.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles.
Come on, declare it.
personal Savior. You are the risen
you down. We're
lift our voice in victory. We're gonna make your praises loud. The enemy has been defeated, and death couldn't hold you down. We're gonna lift our voice in victory. We're gonna make your praises loud.
The enemy's been defeated. Victory over death. Come on, you don't have to die in Paris and go to a hell, an eternal hell of torment. This morning you can go to eternity and spend it forever with Him, because He's won the victory this morning. Hallelujah. Can we go ahead and turn the lights on? Come on and just lift your hands all across the house today. There's victory in here this morning. Oh, I need to hear from some witnesses today to say that Jesus won the victory for me. I need to hear some witnesses today to worship God that would say He won something for me. There's a battle I was fighting that I couldn't win, but all because Jesus came. I've won the victory today. Oh, come on and worship Him. Worship Him today. Oh, give Him glory today. Jesus, Jesus, there's no other name. Give you the highest praise. We give you the highest praise. Oh, come on, out of your own mouth, let a sound of revival come. This generation needs to hear the sound of revival again. This generation needs to hear some mamas and daddies pray through again. Oh, come on, press in, men and women of God. Press in, men and women of God. Some of you are only going to get the victory when you begin to press in this morning. You've been fighting and you've been striving. Oh, but I got a word for you today. The victory has come. And His name is Jesus. Hope has a name. Love has a name. Joy has a name. And that name is Jesus this morning. Oh, lift that name up today. Lift that name up today. Jesus. When you can't say anything else, just say Jesus. When you don't know who to call to, just say Jesus. When you don't know where to turn, just say Jesus. There's victory in the name of Jesus. There's hope in the name of Jesus. of Jesus. There's perseverance in the name of Jesus. Oh, you'll run and not grow weary through the name of Jesus. You'll walk and not grow faint in the name of Jesus. You're more than conquerors in the name of Jesus. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Oh, He's our soon coming King. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Demons have to flee at the name of Jesus. Darkness has to turn at the light of Jesus. Come on and somebody shout the name of Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. Oh, yes, Lord. Come on and find somebody you don't know this morning and hug their neck and tell them you're glad to see them, you're glad to meet them. I want you to get out of your seat and out of the aisles. Come on and find somebody with you this morning. Tell them you're glad to be here and you're glad they're here. How many of you are thankful for the victory of Jesus today? How many of us are here are thankful that I have everything that I've got? He's blessed me abundantly. I need our ushers to go ahead and join me up front here today. We're going to move into a time of worship and giving. Now listen, we give our tithe and our offering. We've started this. This is a new practice or a revisited practice for us. For the longest time, we just did the black boxes, and those are available to you. There's a black box in the back of the sanctuary, beside the front entrance. It's weird, the back of the sanctuary, but it's the front entrance. There's a black box sitting by the door right there, and there's a black box at the door back here. If you go to pick up your kids, you can drop them off there. You can give them into the bags this morning. You can also give online at our website, remedychurchnc.org. You can go there and give online if it's convenient for you. A lot of times we talk about giving as worship to God. Those of you who practice the giving of your tithe and offering, you know what it means to give tithe. Look, the tithe is not God trying to withdraw something from your bank account. The tithe is God trying to get into your bank account. Some of y'all don't understand that. But for the ones that you pay your tithe, and there's been a time where you didn't have money to pay your bills, but you paid your tithe, and all of a sudden money just started flowing in. God's not trying to take away from you. He's trying to get inside of you and every part of you. Let me not preach on giving this morning. We'll do that another time. But what I'm going to tell you right now is if you will give your 10% to God, God will get in your 90. And He'll give it to you pressed down, shaken together, and running over. There's an overflow that happens to the generous heart. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost in here today, Brother Gene. So we want to give unto God as worship. I want Him in every area of my life to reign supreme. If it's your first time with us today, you heard it mentioned that we have a prayer card that we give you in our bulletin. It's just a little flap that folds out. If this is your first time, or maybe it's your second or third, maybe sixth time, I don't know, you're a newcomer, you've never filled that out, we want you to fill that card out for us. Because what that's going to allow us to do is to pray with you over the need that you write down. There's a box there for your need. We want you to write a need down and turn that in to these bags this morning. We don't expect any money from you if you're a newcomer or a first-time guest.
What we do want you to do is fill that prayer request card out, that prayer card out, so that we can follow up and see how God's moving in your life, because we believe in the power of prayer. And we are going to pray over these needs. The leadership are going to be sharing these with one another and praying over your needs. We love you and we care about you as brothers and sisters in Christ. Look, you are a son or a daughter of Jesus Christ. It's just whether you've realized it yet or not. Okay, so today, if you'll fill out that prayer card, if it's your first time or you're a newcomer, just slip it in the bag. Remedy, let's give unto the Lord as worship this morning, sacrificially and liberally. Let's ask God to touch this offering today. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just come before you today, and we ask you that you would just bless this offering, this giving of tithe and offering this morning, God. Lord, that you would not let the giving return void to the giver, but God, you would bless the giver that's sowing seed, good seed into good soil this morning. And God, as we invest in the kingdom, God, we pray that you would just continue to invest in our lives as we're made available to you. We give you glory, honor, and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you as you give this morning.
Welcome to Romy. We are so glad to have you. Please feel free to worship with us and we just take everything we have to the Lord today. At Remedy, we believe in the power of prayer. That is why if you look at the back of your bulletin, you'll find a prayer card. We ask that you please turn it into the Connect Center so that we can pray for you and stay in touch. Here's some updates for what's going on in the church. Your trip begins on May 6th. Don't forget to sign up at the Connect Center. Our next lunch with the pastor will be on May 27th. If you are new to or have recently started attending Remedy, we would love for you to join us to learn more about our church. Please sign up at the Connect Center. We will be having water baptisms on April 29th. And the district service will also be on April 29th. Please join us for our lovely night of worship. And Mother's Day is on May 13th. Invite every mom that you know to come celebrate on this special day. We will be having some giveaways for our moms. We want to see you and all of your family come have a great day with us at Mother's Day. Also on Mother's Day, the Remedy Kids class has raised enough money to make our youth pastor, Alex, kiss a pig, so you won't want to miss out on that. If you would like to give at Remedy, we have several ways to do so. You can drop your tithing envelope into the black boxes, or you can give online at our website. Thank you and have a wonderful day.
The lunch with Pastor, let me make a correction, is the 27th, not the 22nd. It's the 27th. You saw tonight. What's tonight? District service. What time? 6 o'clock tonight here. We're going to bring out chairs. We're going to fill the house up with the Kannapolis District Churches of God in Western North Carolina. How many of you are excited we get to host it? It's the first time we get to host it in 30 years. First time we've had one in 30 years. Listen, if you can help tonight, we're having a fellowship afterwards. We're going to be serving hot dogs and some side items and things. And if you can volunteer your time, you can step out a little bit early from service and help Sister Megan serve that fellowship tonight. It'd be great. There's not a lot to it. Just asking for help from anybody who can. I'm thankful for my wife, my helpmate. She helps me in every area that I need it. Some areas I don't think I need it, but she helps me anyway. And I'm thankful for that. But I'm excited about district service tonight. Immediately after service, we're going to have baptisms today. It's going to be a great day in the Lord. I'm so glad that you're here. Isaiah chapter 41, verses 10 through 13. I'll read something to you real quick before we get in there. You're always fighting for us. Heaven's angels all around. My delight is found in knowing that you wear the victor's crown. You're my help, my defender. You're my Savior and my friend. By your grace, I live and breathe to worship you. At the mention of your greatness, in your name, I will bow down. In your presence, fear is silent, for you wear the victor's crown.
Let your glory fill this temple. Let your power overflow. By your grace, I live and breathe to worship you. Darlene Check at Hillsong writes these lyrics, and I wonder how many of us sing this song with our lives. Many times the words we say are just idle, filling space without any real or great meaning to them. But how many of you know that God desires our worship? Our worship is an overflow of living life in a spirit of victory. We talk about these sort of things all the time, freedom, deliverance, victory, but how much do we truly know about them? That's the question. Do we truly know what it means to walk in the victory of Jesus? I hope that you will when you leave this morning. Isaiah chapter 41, verses 10 through 13, if you'll read with me, it says, "Don't be afraid, for I'm with you. Don't be discouraged, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will hold you up with my victorious," say victorious, "right hand. See all your angry enemies lie there, confused and humiliated. Anyone who opposes you will die and come to nothing. You will look in vain for those who tried to conquer you, those who attack you. They'll come to nothing. For I hold you by your right hand. I, the Lord your God, and I say to you, don't be afraid. I am here to help you." Father, in the name of Jesus, touch your word this morning. Touch your people this morning. Touch your servant this morning. God, I pray that you would anoint me. And as you've asked me to speak unto your people today, God, I pray that you would help me to bring a word of encouragement to those who are hurting. God, a word of assurance to those who are uncertain. God, I pray that this morning my words would be few, but your anointing and your impact would be great. God, let me not say anything more than what you would have me to say. And God, I pray that you would anoint the ears of the hearer this morning to hear what thus saith the Lord. God, as I speak, I'd be a vessel to you and nothing more. God, I pray that you would just help us to learn together and to grow together this morning in what it is to walk in victory with Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Don't be afraid, for I'm with you. Isaiah the prophet speaking to Israel, God's people here. Much of Isaiah's word from the Lord is cast with justice, judgment toward the nation. I've had so many people come to me and say, "Pastor, I just hate when I'm in the book of Isaiah." I say, "Why?" They say, "Because I'm tired of reading about judgment. I want to hear about blessing, and I want to hear about glory and favor and all of those things." But Isaiah is a major prophet in the Bible. He brought a prophetic word that was often cast with justice and judgment toward the nation of Israel. But I noticed something through several of the chapters woven throughout the word that Isaiah speaks and writes is God's unending and gracious love toward his people. As we look at this passage of Scripture, we can see some really profound things about living a victorious life in God. The words written to Israel echo to us today through Jesus that died for the promises of God to be available to you and I. So while a lot of people would say, oh, the Old Testament doesn't apply to us anymore, I'm thankful for Jesus because now I have access to the same things that God's people did before Jesus made the new covenant with us. You see, without Jesus, I'm cut off from some of the Word of God. But with Jesus, I'm given everything. I can rightly divide what He says. I'm given every spiritual blessing that was ever given to God's chosen people because you see now, He has become Messiah and King to both Jew and to Gentile. And because I am not a Jew, I'm thankful that God sent Jesus to die for my sin, that I could spend eternity with Him, but also that I could have a covenant with Him while I'm here on the earth. Because in the covenant, I find so many promises that allow me to live a life that I could not live had Jesus not come. The words written to Israel echo to you and I today because they're available to us. And I see a couple of things that I want to talk to you about today in the middle of Isaiah chapter 41 as God speaks through Isaiah to the people of Israel. The first thing that I see is that we don't have to walk in fear because God walks with us. I'm thankful that I don't have to live in fear today. That I don't have to fear anything around me, anybody around me, the time that I live in, or who tries to persecute me because of who Jesus is. The Bible says that that I am with you. God is telling us that His presence is near us, and the presence of God is strength to the believer. If you don't know that, you need to know that. The presence of God is strength to the believer. Living out a life of faith in Jesus is heavily tied to the understanding that knowing that God is near. If I'm living out my faith, I want to know that the one that I have faith in is close beside me. I don't want to serve a God that is far off and distant. I don't want to serve a God that does not hear me when I pray. I don't want to serve a God that does not know me inside and out or my circumstance. I want to know a God, and I want to serve a God who is near me at all times. And when God is near to us, we find strength and confidence. And here's why. He's the creator of all things. He set everything that exists into motion with an order and a purpose. We can trust in His knowledge today. He's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. There is no generation that is forgotten by our God. He is the great I Am. Whatever you need, He can supply. He is the solution to every problem. He is Emmanuel. He is God with us, and He is with us at all times. He is Wonderful Counselor, Almighty God, Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. He is the Good Shepherd. Where you go, He leads and He guides. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for Thou, O Lord, art with me. He is the bright and morning star, shining bright in the middle of our darkness. He is the author and the finisher of our faith, so He remembers where you started, and guess what? He knows where you'll finish. He is the good Father. That is just who He is. In Him, there is protection, there is blessing, and there is favor. He is the Comforter, and in Him, I can find my rest. He is the King of Kings, and He is the Lord of Lords. No one can stand to His authority. He is the soon-coming King. Every knee will bow, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. You see, His nearness to us brings us authority in the Spirit. He understood that we needed more strength than physical strength, that we needed spiritual strength. He tells us, don't be discouraged. Oh, I could hang out there for just a moment. We got too many weak, bleeding out, anemic Christians that are lying in their pity and complaining because of their circumstance. And I'm not belittling anybody's circumstance, but what I'm telling you is that if you get down on your knees and you call to a man named Jesus, wherever you are, He will meet you. You see, I'm not coming with an empty gun this morning. I've got ammo behind what I'm saying. And it's because of my experience and who He is. And I'm thankful for every fire that I've walked through. Not because it was fun, but because it proved to me who my Jesus was. I'm thankful for every trial and circumstance, not because I had a good time in it, but it's because He gave me a perspective when I changed who I was. And I became a new creation that I can walk through the fire and not just come out on the other side, but I can look back and say, look what the Lord has done. And I can walk forward and I can tell other people, look what the Lord has done. And when the next fire comes, I can look back at that fire and say, He'll do it again. I'm thankful for a God that doesn't leave me or forsake me this morning. I don't have to be discouraged. And Christian, listen to me today. You don't have to complain. You don't have to be discouraged. You don't have to hold on to your mess. You can let it go and release it because the Bible said, and your Jesus said, that all who are labored and heavy laden can come to me, and I will give them. Don't be discouraged. I am your God. If there was any other God who said that, it wouldn't matter. But guess what? There is no other God that can speak.
There's only one God that can talk, and when our God says something, it shall be so. For God is not a man that he should lie, but God is a man full of truth and wisdom, and all knowledge is his. He is in every time and space. He is God of the past, God of the present, and God of the future. He is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the God in whom I can put my trust. And I am thankful this morning that I don't get discouraged, because I know the victor this morning who won the victory 2,000 years ago for me. And we got some people this morning that are about to make a declaration in their life publicly to say, I'm serving Jesus and He's the King of my heart. And there's something that has to change when you make that declaration. You see, there should be no more discouragement in you. And I'm not telling you that there aren't times where your soul doesn't feel downcast, because David told us that he had to encourage himself in the Lord. But what I will tell you is this, that you should not be stuck in a place of discouragement, feeling hopeless and lifeless without any way out. Your God provides a way where there is no way. Your God makes the impossible possible. There is nothing that shall be impossible with God. I'm thankful that I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. We say it, but do we believe it this morning? Philippians 4 gives us all kinds of blessings in Him. It tells us to be anxious about nothing. Don't worry about anything, but in all things, through prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, to plead unto God your petitions, and He will protect your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. I'm thankful for Christ Jesus, that when my mind tries to wander, He brings me back. I'm thankful for Christ Jesus, that when my heart is broken, He can mend it this morning. I don't have to lie in discouragement, because He is my God. There's a hope in God. There is encouragement in Him. If you're in a relationship with God, He's not going to let you down. Some of us have lost hope in Him. Some of us have thought that when we prayed the prayer and we believed by faith that right then and there God was going to give us the answer. Many of us miss the answer because the answer doesn't look like what we thought it would look like. Many of us give up on God because He doesn't answer in the timing that we believe He should answer. But I've got to tell you that if God knows everything, that He's got the right timing for everything. That if you get a blessing too early, it will be a curse unto you. He's an on-time God. I'm thankful for the fact that no matter where I am, He is with me, because He's already been in my tomorrow and He knows what tomorrow looks like. And some of us are praying for things that He'll give us tomorrow that we don't need tomorrow. And we're waking up in discouragement and despair because the enemy gets into our hearts and tells us that God is not listening. But God hears you, believer. Son or daughter of God, He hears you right where you are. He's there in the midnight when you're crying. He's there when you can't go to sleep at night and you're worrying over this thing. He's there when you don't feel like anybody else understands what you're going through. He's there when you're about to break down and have a panic attack and a nervous attack and have all kinds of anxiety and fear run through. But the words echo again, don't fear, because I am your God and I walk with you. There's hope in Him. Our discouragement often comes from a place of feeling helplessness. But God takes care of this place in us because He's a helper to the helpless. Psalm 10:14. I'm going to tell you right now that God, He's waging war for your soul. When you become a believer, He enlists you into the army that wages war for the souls of many. And if you take a look at the military and you take a look at war, any army has an obligation. War obligates an army to have resources. When the resources run out, victories run out. You cannot win if your opponent can outgun you and outman you. But I'm thankful that God's mercies are new every single morning. Oh, I'm thankful that grace covers a multitude of sin. If God is love, then love never gives up. It never loses hope. It always perseveres, and love never, ever fails. His resources are without end. He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. He is a God that never runs out of time, and He's never contained within time. He is a God that can move in any way, shape, or form and through anyone that He wants to. He'll take anybody that we say is not worthy, and He'll confound the wise with the things that are foolish. He'll take the things that are weak and confound the things that are strong. You see, He created everything, so He has access to everything. You see, there is nothing that is without or without His reach or beyond who He is. It doesn't matter how chained up you are or how bound up you are. There, you are never too far down or too far gone for God to reach you where you're at. His resources are endless. He is a God who is the bright and morning star. The sun rises and sets on Him. One day Joshua, who followed Moses, prayed for God to make the sun stand still so that he could complete the task of driving out the enemy's armies. And God made the sun stand still in the middle of the sky. It's never happened before and it'll never happen again, but He made the sun stand still for Joshua to complete what He had asked him to do. His resources never run out. Fear comes from helplessness. It comes from a place of the unknown. But when you know the One who knows every hair on your head, you don't have to fear. When you know the One who knows everything, you've got solution at your fingertips. It's not very practical when you say it, but that's why faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen in Hebrews 11, chapter 1. That's why God tells us to walk by faith and not by sight. That's why the Bible says that we are saved by grace through faith and not works, lest any man should boast. But it is the gift of God for eternal life. I thank God that one day I'm going to see Him as He is if I live by faith. Because this fairy tale and this story that people look at and try to discount is a true account of the one true God. It is not a fable made up. They can call it what they want to, but I still believe that there's going to be a meeting in the air, and I'm going to see Him in the sweet by and by. I still think that I have the amazing grace of God. So I'm going to stay on the firing line. I know that He set me free. And I know that one day I will fly away. And everything that we sing about and everything that we talk about will no longer be music notes on a red-backed hymnal page. But it'll be the reality of a Jesus Christ that died, was buried, and resurrected. And now steps foot on the earth to reign supreme forevermore. I hope this kind of preaching is okay with you this morning. I'm just a little old school from time to time, and I can't help it. But when I talk about victory, I need you to know that there is no devil in hell that can come against you that shall overtake you, because Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. This is some old-time preaching, but it's all-time good. I'm telling you that God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. My God, I feel Him in here this morning. We don't have to walk in fear because God walks with us. I see that in Isaiah 41. I also see that failure will happen. But that His strength is greater than any weight that we carry. I know that failure will happen because in Isaiah 41, verses 10 through 13, He says, I will hold you up with my victorious, say victorious, right hand. I will hold you up with my victorious right hand. Come on, say that with me. I will hold you up with my victorious right hand. That's a declaration this morning. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm glad you sat next to me this morning because you're about to see some victory. I know you need to see victory, and I'm about to show it to you. We've got to get to victory this morning, I'm telling you. We've got to start walking as He's called to walk. You think that things are going wrong because God's not answering. Things are going wrong because you're not crying out like you're supposed to. We have lost an agony in the church over the things that break the heart of God. And we need to get back to a place where our agony meets God's heart, and He is so broken for us that He begins to move for His sons and daughters again. That's called praying through. That's called getting on my knees. And many of us think that as the enemy attacks, I said I was going to take it easy with my voice this morning. We got to get through two services today, but I can't help it. Some of us think that we're being driven to our knees and it's a place of burden, but the place of victory is on your knees through Jesus Christ. You see, the devil thinks he's pinning you down, but all he is doing is driving himself into a corner and a trap, because when you get to your knees, something's going to change. Oh, devil, you can fight me all you want to, but when I get to my knees, victory comes. Oh, devil, you can do what you want to and use who you want to get at me, but when I get to my knees, God comes running. Oh, you can drive me down, devil, but when I get to my knees, prayers start getting answered. Oh, you can do what you want to and be who you want to and function how you want to, and you can be in whatever pattern you want to, but when I get to my knees, all you're doing is driving me to victory. I'm thankful to God that in the place of humility is the place of victory this morning, because had it not been for Jesus, my place of humility would be in vain and I'd be cut off from Him. But thank God that He went to intercede for me at the right hand of the Father, that when I pray to Him, I can come boldly into the throne room of grace, and He hears my petitions this morning. Are you thankful for the victorious hand of God? Can I tell you, there are two ways to view failure in your life at all times. First, I can see failure as a roadblock to my future and success, or I can see failure as an opportunity to see God's strength. Many will tell you that failure is not an option, and they will weigh you down with unrealistic expectations, thinking that because Jesus is in you, a lot of times we make ourselves Jesus. Unrealistic expectations, and people come to the altar and pray to a God that we tell loves them, and once they're saved and they get up, we slap expectations on them that they can never meet. They claim, these kinds of people will claim that they have overcome all kinds of sin and no longer struggle with anything, and I want the manual for that one. Here's where I need to divert for 1 second. God loves you, and His grace is for you, but His grace will not allow you to stay where you are. Even though His grace covers a multitude of sin, grace is not a license to go and do what you want to and expect God to chase you down and pet you when you realize something was wrong with what you've done or who you've been. Grace is an opportunity to say that I honestly came to a place where I understood who God was and I accepted His love. And today I didn't meet the mark, but tomorrow I'm going to get up and I'm going to do it all over again because His grace allows me to. I'm thankful that in any moment His grace will come to me and allow for forgiveness to happen. That no matter what past I've got, no matter what has separated me from God, that He can take that and toss it, as they say, as far as the east is to the west. It'll never be met again. God can save us and will save us if we ask Him to through grace by our faith. But our grace must be something that drives us further and further away from who we used to be and closer to who He wants us to be. There is a difference between falling and laying down. Some of y'all didn't like that. There is a difference between falling and laying down. There is a conscious component to your spiritual posture. There's a component of you that makes a decision to either stand in Christ or lie down in your circumstance. There is a conscious decision that is made about my posture. I was driving down the road the other day. We went to Riverbank Zoo, and this was yesterday. We went to Riverbank Zoo yesterday in Columbia. Awesome. We had a great time with family. It was amazing. But on the way home, I noticed that we were driving down the interstate, and I noticed myself I was doing this as I drove. Anybody ever do that? You just, somehow your posture just, and that's kind of like us spiritually. A lot of us get hunched back and ugly without realizing it. I ain't pointing no fingers this morning. But we get hunchbacked and we're sitting there and we're focused on the road and we don't realize what's happening to our posture. But there are some moments that we come to ourselves and we realize, you know what, my back kind of hurts. And that happened to me yesterday, and I made a conscious decision to sit up straight. Because I knew in the long run, if I don't make this conscious decision, and if I let this continue to happen, I'm going to be in pain when I get to where I'm going. God doesn't look to cause you pain so that you'll fall down. God looks to use your pain so that when you get where you're going, you'll be stronger because you've got experience. There's a conscious component to your spiritual posture in God. 1 Samuel 16:7 says this, that God is not looking at your outward person. He's fixed on your character and integrity because God spoke to Samuel when he went to anoint David and said, God doesn't look on the outward appearance, but on the heart. It's time to stop getting kicked around spiritually by the devil and stand up. Well, Pastor, I just can't make it and stand up. Wrong. Proverbs 24:16 says the godly may trip seven times, but they will get up again. But one disaster is enough to overthrow the wicked. So we need to do a spiritual pulse check this morning. Am I in God or am I not? Can I get up out of my situation? If the answer is no, then you need to get back into right alignment with who God has called you to be. You have walked away somewhere because the godly may trip seven times, but the Bible says they will. It's a guarantee. It's a promise that they will get up again. I'm thankful that that ending of that verse says that one disaster is enough to overthrow the wicked, because it's telling me that if I pursue him, I might trip, but I can get back up. But on the contrary, that I've got good news for somebody today. We have an adversary, and he is wicked. And my God, if he's the God of everything, he can cause a disaster for the enemy. And that means that, devil, you are overthrown in my life. I'm thankful that as I pursue him, if I'm falling, I can get up. And if I'm wicked, it's going to overthrow me. But I'm thankful that as I get up, I don't have to mess with the enemy anymore. He's overthrown because God is causing a disaster through your blessing for him. God's not just blessing you to bless you. He's blessing you to also thwart the enemy in the earth. Because every time you get up again, God is thwarting the enemy for somebody else. He's knocking the enemy back down, and they're looking at, that's why the Bible said they're overcomers by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. It's because when you get back up, it becomes a testimony for others to see. A watching world sees your testimony, and they come back and say, well, if he can do that for them, I know he can do it for me. I'm thankful that a God would use a low-down, busted-up sinner like me to save somebody through the testimony that he has given me. The adversary is wicked, but he can be overthrown. I believe the devil is on his way out of somebody's life this morning because I'm asking God to absolutely wreck somebody's life. I'm asking for a spiritual disaster, a righteous disaster to happen in somebody's spirit today so that the enemy will be overthrown. The Bible says he holds our right hand, whispering strength to our spirit. He said in Isaiah 41, the ending of this passage, he says, I will hold you by your right hand. So not only is he upholding us with his victorious right hand, he's holding us by our right hand. He says, I will hold you by your right hand, I, the Lord your God, and I say to you, again, he starts it with don't be afraid, and he ends it, don't be afraid, I'm here to help you. God with his victorious hand, some translations say right hand, upholds you. God's right hand is used in Scripture often by describing the strength of God. It describes God's military might.
And by doing so, it describes God's ability to protect His people. Many will never accept this help because their pride doesn't allow them to. It doesn't allow them to lean into the strength of God. No, they want to complete the task. They want to run the race. They want to fight the battle on their own. Because at the end, the victor gets the spoils. And many of us are not willing to let go of the result and the spoils of our war. We want to be able to claim and brag about what it is that we have done and what we have fought through, because the pattern of the world tells us that we can master anything. But if you will be mastered this morning by God, and let Him be the one that guides you, and let Him be the one who is over you, you will always be victorious. You see, in the path of trying to be victorious on my own, I find defeat. But in the path that I find in God upholding me in His victory and in His strength, I myself find victory in my hands. Your life will be victorious when you come to the realization that while you have strength, it's not your strength that overcomes. God partners with you. He says, I will hold your right hand. He's strengthening us through an alliance. Evan Andrews writes about the origin of a handshake, and he says one of the earliest depictions of a handshake is found in a 9th century B.C. relief, which shows the Assyrian king Shalmaneser III pressing his flesh with a Babylonian ruler to seal an alliance. It's also a recurring motif in the 4th and 5th century B.C. Greek funerary art. In Rome, the handshake was often used as a symbol of friendship and loyalty. Many signs point to the handshake being a symbol of good faith when making an oath or a promise. When people clasped hands, people showed that their word was a sacred bond. It's hard to find this in humanity anymore. But I'm thankful that the Bible says that I am God and I change not. An agreement can be expressed. Walter Burkhart says an agreement can be expressed quickly and clearly in words, but it's only made effective by a ritual gesture. Open and weaponless hands stretched out toward one another, grasping each other in a mutual handshake. God does not just speak His words. He gives us a gesture, and then another gesture, and then another gesture. If our words are made true by the actions that we take, God is the truest of truths. He is the one that speaks and things come to being. Whether they are now or they are not, it is by God that things will come to pass. He sent His Son Jesus to die for you so that you can have eternal life. He created you with your gifting and your passions and purpose. He's walked with you into the dark places of your life and into the hard circumstances that you're walking in right now. I know there's somebody in the house today that you'd say, I'm walking through something I don't feel like I've ever walked through before. I don't ever remember feeling like this. And I need my God to move again. All you have to do is say the name of Jesus, and He comes running with the resources of heaven alongside Him. God has never left you. You might not have always been aware of His presence working in your life, but He has always been there. And He's with you now. In this moment, He's with you now. He's divinely appointed today for you. And I say this all the time, that I don't believe in circumstances or happenstance. I don't believe in chance. I believe that God divinely appoints things for people. And I wonder today if there's somebody in here that God sees you in your mess, and He's reaching His hand down. He says, don't be afraid. I'll uphold you with my victorious right hand. He He's looking at you and he's saying, you might feel like you got enemies on every side. Those enemies, if you'll just take my hand, they'll be scattered. He say, you might feel like you're being persecuted, like things are going wrong every which way. Every time you turn around, there is some kind of struggle that's happening. But if you'll just take my hand, my victorious, righteous right hand. The words of Isaiah echo to us in today's generation to say, people of God, sons and daughters, if you will take my right hand one more time, I'm going to lead you out of the fire. Some of us have taken His hand time and time again. And many of us are walking through a valley and we're going, oh God, not again. Oh God, not this valley. Some of us have been waiting and wondering, is this the valley that I'm going to have to walk through? And some of us have gotten news that we just stepped foot in the valley of the shadow of death and God has His hand extended out and He's saying, will you take my hand? Will you take my victorious, righteous right hand? Look, His promise to you is not that He will pet you and make you feel better and not do anything about it. His promise to you is that I will uphold you. Your job is to keep walking. Your job is to persevere. I'm not saying being a Christian is easy. And I'm not saying that walking with Jesus is easy and it's something that is just going to come natural when you say a prayer and an altar. But what I'm saying is this, is that when you put your hope and your life in Him, whenever you walk, if you trip, He grabs you. He just reaches your hand out. His hand will hold you up. I'm falling, Pastor. You don't have to keep falling. You don't have to keep struggling and striving in the same place you're in. You don't have to be looking at the valley that's ahead going, I don't know if I can do this, God. I don't know why this is in front of me. And God is saying, if you'll just take my hand, I'll lead you right through it. God, I don't know if I can make it through this. I don't know if I can handle it. My nerves are shot. My kids have got this going on and that going on. I've got all kinds of crazy schedules and I've got all kinds of crazy burdens and I've got all kinds of heaviness on my life and I can't make it. He said, I didn't ask you. I just asked you to take my hand. I just asked you to walk by faith and not by sight. And I'm asking you this morning to take my hand and I will lead you through it. There's another place in Isaiah that he says that I will be with you when you go through the deep waters. That no matter how much I feel like I'm being overtaken, because of Jesus, I will not be overwhelmed. And he says, I uphold you by your right hand, I the Lord your God. And I say to you, don't be discouraged. I'm here to help you. Would you stand all over the house today? Every head bowed and every eye closed, you say, Pastor, I'm walking through a valley this morning. And I see God reaching His hand out to me this morning. And you say, Pastor, I want to make the conscious decision. I know that there is a conscious component to my spiritual posture. If I'm feeling weighed down, I could stand up in Jesus Christ and I want to take His hand. Would you just lift your hand up? I just want to take His hand. Anyone else this morning? Thank you. Thank you. If you would take one step of faith this morning, still with every head bowed and every eye closed, I want to give you the opportunity to step out of your seat this morning with nobody looking around. Would you step out of your seat and come to this altar and say, I need victory in my circumstance today. I need to live a victorious life. I can live in victory through Him. I can take His hand this morning and He can lead me through. Would you do that this morning? Step out of your seat and come down here and let God begin to work on your heart.
Let God begin to work on your mind the places that the devil has tried to get in and tell you that this is not going to end, that you're not going to make it, that you can make it because you take the right hand of Jesus this morning. Would you just answer the urgency in your spirit? Some of you are about to step into a new chapter in life and you're uncertain and you're afraid. God is speaking this morning. Is there anyone else who would step out and say, I need to answer the urgency of my spirit today? I need God to move in my circumstance. I need victory in my life. In the name of Jesus, would you just begin to pray with those that have come? Just lift your hands all across the house today. Father, in the name of Jesus, for every person in the house, God, that lifted their hand or came to the altar today, I pray that you would make good on your oath. Make good on your word today, God. Not that you're obligated by us, but God, in your character and integrity and in your goodness, God, you reign supreme and your word is true. God, we know that if you're good enough to speak it, you're good enough to do it. God, we just declare today that victory will reign, that you are the King of our hearts. And God, there is none other like you in all the earth. And so, God, we just lift you up today in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. We want you to hang out with us a little bit today. We've got a special thing that we're going to be doing. We're doing water baptism today. So if you're being baptized, I'm going to ask you to go out this door right here. There are bathrooms in the back hallway that you can go and change into the clothes that you need to change into to be baptized. You can go ahead and go do that now. Just on the stage right here to the right. We're going to let them go get changed. I told everybody last time I did this, it was the polar plunge. It was cold. We got it warm this morning. Some of these teenagers that got baptized be like, thanks a lot, Pastor. But we're going to let them get changed, hang out with us, fellowship with one another for just a minute. We're thankful today that over the past few months we've had
more than this, but seven lives were given their hearts to Jesus. They wanted to make their faith a declaration, a public declaration today that they're following Jesus with their hearts, their minds. We're going to celebrate that today with water baptism. We're thankful that you're staying with us and celebrating with you. We are a family. Amen. We support one another in our successes and our failures. We're there for one another. So thank you for staying. I'm going to ask the first candidate for baptism to come down. This is Ben Baker. He has recently given his heart to Jesus. This is what you think about the Lord. God's great. Life is gone. And when I come out of the water, I'm a new creation in Christ. my ways change, my people change, my personhood changes, my character changes, I'm being conformed into the likeness of Jesus. It's a personal declaration to us as the church to support them in their successes and failures and to hold them accountable to the word in which they have given their life to. I'm so thankful for these seven that have given their hearts to Jesus. Let's give God one more hand clap of praise. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you for today and all that you've done and all you're doing. God, we pray that you would just bless those that have given their hearts to you and help us to be a church that supports them and holds them accountable to your word and the standard of who you are, God, and that we would help them as they follow you, as you lead and guide them in their life. God, I pray that you would just continue to bless Remedy Church. Help us to be soul winners and disciple makers. God, we give you glory and honor and praise for the rest of this day. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you. We'll see you tonight at 6 p.m. for district service.